Hey there, people of Microbuilds. Well, the amp is finished. It's been a really long time, and I'm really glad to say that this amp is officially done. So, the first completed video I posted was actually YouTube Shorts. I figured that out finally. So, we got that done. So, we have that power brick, which is surge protected, and we plug our amp into that, but this amp is also fused. So this is double protected because high voltage is dangerous. Instead of using the cables I made, I use these two, like this little thin cord with these little, like, what do you call these? Adapters for the inputs and the output of the stereo. So it would just kind of be a little more compact because the 90 degree angles, cables that I made are more for, like, if you're actually playing guitar or if the amp is kind of up against a wall. So, to compensate for this, I just got this cable so I could have, like, a straight angle connector so I'm not putting strain on anything, just for this video, just because. Here's an example of one of the 90 degree cables that I made, which is kind of going up to the speaker in there. I don't know if you can see that. Here, let me grab a flashlight real quick. Let's see. Yeah, there you go. There's some bracket holes up there that I put a zip tie through, and now we got a little strain relief up in there. So that's cool. As for the rest of this amp, originally amps like this will tend to sound kind of trashy. No particular reason, it's just, it's how that is. The capacitors typically will need some time to get kind of weathered, if you will. Brand new out of the box, I don't know what's really wrong with them at first, but some kind of specification is really unhappy with them. So they need a while to be applied to the high voltage for a good decent amount of time, usually around 4 hours in my case. In order to get the amp to sounding actually decent, because at first, this sounded like older than vacuum tubes, which is just nuts, because it's not that old. Yeah, sorry, that turned into a rant. Not the point. So, the 5Y3 rectifier is a dual diode, so that means it has two plates and a single cathode, but the GT at the end, so there's a 5Y3 and a 5Y3 GT. The difference is that the 5Y3 GT, the heater is the cathode, so you would just have another wire off either side of the cathode, and that would be your high voltage source in reference from the chassis, which is common ground. And then the 12AX7 is a dual triode, so it has two plates, two grids, two cathodes, all of which are independent from each other. Separated into two triodes, and then a common filament, which can be used in one or two halves. You can use the 12AX7 like a single triode, but it's kind of a waste when there's two in there. They do make other single triode tubes, which would be better fitted if you only need one half of the tube. The 6V6 GT is what is called a beam power tube. The beam power tube has five total electrodes in there. And three of them are grids, one is a plate, and one's a cathode. Now, for this family of tubes, there's not really one specific family, but for this kind of model number, like the 12AX7, 5Y3 GT, and 6V6 GT, now mind you, this is not for all tubes, but this is, in fact, for most of them. The model number will tell you the most important specifications of the tubes, others will be needed to reference to the data sheet. So, let's take a look at the first tube, which is the 12AX7. So, the heater voltage is 12, which is the first number. AX is the factory specification. And the 7 is how many useful elements are in the tube. So, we have two plates, two grids, that makes 4. Two cathodes, that makes 6. And then a heater, so that's 7. So then, the next tube is the 5Y3 GT. The heater voltage is 5, Y is the factory specification, 3 is the number of useful elements, the cathode, which is also just the heater, and 2 plates, so that makes 3. GT is just more factory specs. Same with the 6V6, the heater voltage is 6.3, but we abbreviate it to 6. The 12AX7 is more like 12 point something. No, it would be 12.6 for really, but we just abbreviate them. So it is 6 volts for the heater on the 6V6. V is a factory spec. 6 is useful elements because we got 5 electrodes, the plate, 3 grids, and a cathode, plus the heater, which makes it the pentode. Fun fact, they make this thing called a triode hexode where it's like a hexode tube, except there's also a triode piggybacking in the same glass envelope. It's in the shoulder style format where the tube kind of it like flares up and then restricts and goes straight again. So you can probably hear the amp humming. I'm not exactly sure, but I'm pretty sure you might be able to hear it. This is down to the fact that, yeah, this chassis is completely metal, and these sheet metal screws make this whole thing an a radio frequency shield, which is grounded, so basically all interference is getting dumped. Now, the thing making this humming noise is most likely the heaters. Mind you, I am only 13. This is like the first amp I've ever built. I didn't exactly expect it to not hum. I actually was kind of anticipating like quite a bit of hum. This is not as much as I thought, but this could also be that the volume's turned down. Yeah, so after like past 3, the hum just stays the same volume, which means nothing's wrong with it initially, so that's good. So we have 2 inputs, both of which run through a 68,000 ohm resistor, and from that, they're grounded through a 1 meg resistor, I guess to prevent ground loops, I'd assume. The transformer, it has bolts running through all the laminations, so everything is also grounded in the transformer, except the windings, of course, unless you're talking about the center taps, those are grounded. The output transformer, I bought a fancy one because I can, and it was available. So this one is actually kind of special, and the reason for this is because this output transformer is not the standard 8-ohm output like you would expect on a Fender Champ, or just the single 4-ohm. If you look at the output jacks, you'll notice it is a dual winding. It's actually not dual winding, but there's a center tap for 4-ohm, and then another tap for 8-ohms, and then another tap for the for ground, which is just the common. So I bought a fancy transformer, so technically, I could swap that speaker out. I do have the other one. I will pull it out later. Hopefully in this video, I'll try. So I have the other, it's basically, I like to call it the speaker's brother. This one is the 8-ohm, so it is plugged into the 8-ohm slot. I would have to probably switch out that cable to the other one or use one of my other jacks, and I only have 2 left. I wanted to make a second cable. But I think I'm going to keep it on the 8-ohm because I feel like 8-ohms are easier to maintain and also sound a little better. No specific reason, I just happen to like them. Also, most things are 8-ohm, so instead of using this amp, if I turn the volume all the way down, actually maybe that's not a good idea. You never want to leave a transformer on without loading it down. Transformers always need to have some kind of load on them or you will cook the secondaries. So, I was initially going to consider taking out the 8-ohm cable to show you that you can take that out and completely bypass this entire monstrosity, which is also very beautiful, that is the amplifier, and just run that cable, which goes directly to the speaker, and you could plug literally whatever you want into this, into the speaker cab, which is just shared with the amp. It's kind of huge. So, my hand for reference, this is a really big speaker cabinet, and this amp is also incredibly huge. It definitely didn't feel like it when it came down to wiring. If anybody's ever built anything in a chassis at all, you will know what I'm talking about. To one of my friends at school, volume knob, you're welcome. Anyway, so output transformers. That one's a lot slower to get warm than the power transformer, and I initially was not aware that transformers did get warm. Yeah, I'm a noob. Get over it. So, I didn't know these got warm, and I thought something was initially wrong with the amp, and there was actually nothing wrong with it. Transformers just get smoking hot. And not smoking hot to the point where it's burning you, it's just uncomfortable to leave your hand there, because if it is burning you, you do have something very wrong, most likely in the filter circuitry. And it might take your tubes with it, so that's not good. So you got the volume knob. It's just a 1 meg pot between the two, the plate and the grid of the 12x7. There's also a capacitor in there to give plate voltages to both the plates without having that boost And the second signal running through the audio signal, which will just make the speaker, I would assume, quieter. Because you can, in fact, have AC and DC in the same wire, and the AC will be raised to the amplitude of the DC signal. So if I had this and I applied, like, say, a AA to a speaker like this, you would imagine the speaker would just go boonk, and then it would just stay there. So then if you have, like, that boonk, and then you apply an audio signal, now you have a limited range of travel, where if I let go of that, that excess DC that we don't need, which, mind you, is several hundred volts, 320, but that's still a lot of voltage. If we have that, then your speaker's going to be doing like this, because this will convert high voltage into high current. And high current is what makes speakers do their thing. Not really, but it helps. So this is a 20-watt speaker, so if you had a 1-volt audio signal, you'd need 20 amps-ish. I could have this completely wrong, but I think that's about what it is. So, if you eliminate that DC with a decoupling cap, I have these little yellow polyester caps. I think they're yellow. I'm colorblind. I honestly couldn't tell you. The listing said they were yellow. Anyway, so they're little polyester caps, and they're decoupling caps. They're not only for decoupling, but capacitors will block DC and pass AC. Since the audio signal is AC, it will block the DC. So, what this basically means for the amp is instead of this transformer cooking itself with that high voltage DC, those caps filter it out so the plate voltage is completely independent from the audio signal, so it doesn't cook the output transformer, which would be bad because that thing was like really expensive. I mean, it was only $38, so it was only like $35-ish dollars, but still, I'm a broke teen. Don't bully me. Lol. For the tubes, I actually got a pretty good deal. eBay sold me, I forgot the name of the dude who sold it to me, but some person on eBay sold me that 5Y3 GT rectifier tube for $7. Now, if no one's ever bought a 5Y3 before and they're watching this video, those can run for like $40-ish dollars up to $50 on eBay. And I got mine for $7. The tube itself was only $4. It was the last one, and I feel like the only reason it was so cheap is because the seller probably didn't know its worth, and it was untested, so for all we know, it's really a big gamble on whether or not it was going to work at all. So as for me, I just said to heck with it. It's $7, and it's protected by the money-back guarantee from eBay, so I'm like, to heck, let's get it. So it came in the mail. And it worked fine. There's literally nothing wrong with it. Chances are I could probably flip that tube and make like 50-something dollars off of it. That'd be neat, except I'm going to keep it because it's General Electric and it works and it's nice. So the 6V6, I can't tell if this is a gray or black plate tube. My guess is a black plate because it's darker than the rectifier and the 12AX7. I guess it doesn't really matter. Plus, I'm not sure if that brand is the one for the different shades of plates and everything, and I don't know. That one is a Delta tube. The 12AX7 is JJ. I got it off Tube Depot in a pack of two, and that's obviously General Electric. You can see that right there. So that's the tube set. This is your run-of-the-mill Fender Champ transformer. Your output transformer is a 7,000 ohm primary and a 4 and 8 ohm secondary. It's your basic volume knob with an aluminum cap. It's nothing special, really. So, what this basically means is I have an amp now. Just give me a second. I'm going to try to turn it around because I could probably understand why this would be annoying. If you're sitting here staring at the back of the amp, but you can't see how probably not great the front of this amp is going to look. Fair warning, I have no stain or anything even remotely decorative on the front of this at all. Just a second. Like I said, nothing special. Here you go. So this is the front of it. I don't have any grill cloth. Probably not going to add any. The speaker looks pretty nice. I mean, I don't see anything wrong with it being exposed other than it might get kicked. I actually take pretty good care of my amp. I either leave it on this table or with the speaker facing that, like facing the wall in that little corner right next to that giant light bulb that I have for some reason. Yeah, so it's a 20 watt mod 820 speaker. So 8 inches, 8 ohms, 20 watts, decent highs, lows, speaker stuff that I don't quite understand because I don't know. I just don't. So, yeah. I have a Fender Champ now. I guess I'll try to do a sound test now. That seems to be the only thing left. Also, there's my cable that I made. I had to turn it around, and I feel like it would strain the straight cable. So, just a second.